The NASCAR Pinty Series rolls into North America's oldest road course for race number 8. This tight, challenging road course will play a key role as the championship chase heats up.
As the summer heat intensifies, so does the NASCAR Pinty Series points race. Andrew Ranger has flexed his Mopar muscle in Goliath fashion. The number 27 machine has been consistent and steady across the country. The mission is simple: lock down another Canadian championship. 16-year-old Caden Lapcevich has made his mark throughout Canada, letting everyone know that he's mature beyond his years, plus a big old size 12-foot, as this title contender playing the role of David moving forward. The series has arrived at Trois-Rivières, and there's no show like NASCAR on a street course. This caged playground will be relentless as the fight for the 2016 championship heats up on TSN. Welcome to the Grand Prix of Trois-Rivières as TSN brings you Le 50 Tour presented by Can-Am. We're at the 47th edition of this legendary street course, which plays host to round number 8 of the 2016 NASCAR Pinty Series Championship. I'm Dave Bradley. Along with me is Adam Ross and Todd Lewis. Tanya Baudet are both patrolling the pits. Adam, these events at Trois-Rivières never disappoint.
Dave, Dominic Fougère and his group have the city in a frenzy. If you're a race fan, this is the place to be this weekend. 5 different and unique divisions racing this weekend. It's a favorite stop on the NASCAR Tour.
And talking about the track, it's an 11-turn, 2.46-kilometer circuit, which has played host to many a historic NASCAR battle, including last year when Kevin LaCroix and Andrew Ranger went toe-to-toe in the last couple of corners.
Dave, this is the kind of action our series produces. These cars, you can muscle them around, there's a little bit of contact, and they're not afraid to rub a little bit. What an exciting finish.
They didn't even need the track, and it was Kevin LaCroix who came out ahead by a nose at the line, winning his first Grand Prix of Trois-Rivières.
It's not the first time we've seen a finish that close here, Dave.
Well, this track lends itself to lots of action, lots of places to pass, including turn 6 and even through turn number 3 in the Duplessis gate. A number of drivers joining us once again to the Pinty Series, including the number 99 of Marc-Antoine Cameron.
Great to see Mark back, and with a rare off weekend in the Sprint Cup Series, Go Fast Racing has brought Jeffrey Earnhardt to participate this weekend. Tanya is with him.
Thanks, guys. Jeffrey, first off, welcome to Trois-Rivières. Tell me, as a driver, what was the adjustment you had to make getting into this NASCAR Pinty Series car?
The cars, they like to be driven different. You know, our stock cars, like Xfinity or Cup or even our K&N cars, you can be real aggressive on them. These cars, you got to be a little more finesse. So it's taking a little bit of getting used to, and obviously running on a street course here at Trois-Rivières is a big change. It's no room for error, and you gotta pretty much hope for the best. You got walls on each side, but we've had a few issues, but every time I go out, we get better and better. So as the race goes on, we'll keep adapting to the track, or I will, and the guys will make sure that, you know, the car's good, or if we have any issues, they'll take care of it. But hopefully we can work our way to the front. We got it. A lot of cars to pass, so I guess I might as well make it exciting, right?
Well, thanks and good luck. Guys, we already have a pretty impressive driver's list here, but we'll definitely have to add the Earnhardt's name on it.
Yeah, you got to think of the drivers like Richard Spinard, Ron Fellows, even Jacques Villeneuve and Gilles Villeneuve used to race here as well.
And Gilles Villeneuve, I learned a little bit of history this weekend. His big break to go F1 racing started with the Grand Prix of Trois-Rivières.
Looking at the point standings, it's very close at the top. Andrew Ranger leads, but not by much.
And then you go from third on back, Alex Tagliani, 26 points behind, even though he missed a race. And then LP Dumoulin and Alex LeBay tied 36 points back. There's a number of drivers from fourth back through 10th that are really tight, Dave.
Well, yesterday we had E3 spark plug qualifying here on the Circuit Grand Prix de Trois-Rivières, and it was the 27 of Andrew Ranger who was out quickest to start off, but he didn't stay there.
No, he didn't. Alex Tagliani was the fastest driver in both practice sessions. Everyone expected the EpiPen number 18 to be on the pole position.
But it wasn't Alex Tagliani either. He had to settle for second spot because a little bit of a surprise, the 74 of Kevin LaCroix earns your E3 Spark Plugs pole award.
New power plant under the hood of that race car, and I'm told Don Thompson Jr., the crew chief, found a few things as well.
And with more on how they stack up at the fast end of the grid, here's Todd.
Thanks, guys. It is an exciting group of French-Canadian drivers up near the front of the field. Kevin Lacroix had the fastest time, in fact, setting a new track record in your first visit to Trois-Rivières last year, came away a winner. This year, a new track record. What is it about this track that suits you?
I like being, you know, tight walls. You know, there's some fast corners, some very slow corners. So it's just a mix of everything and technical track. So I think it's a track you can show your talent. And, I'm happy to have shown my talent in qualifying, and hopefully I'll be the same in the race.
Good luck today.
Thank you.
Kevin Lacroix will lead them off. Starting alongside on the front row, the man has been very hot this year. He has three victories. He is third in points. He had his best finish in the Nascar Pinty Series here at Trois-Rivières a year ago. Third, Alex Tagliani, starting on the front row. Can you do better? Can you win today?
We have to win, obviously. Picking up the race that we're missing, we're kind of on a time attack basically until the end of the season. But, you know, really happy to be here. The series doing really well. Pinty's, all the people from Pinty's are here. So it's exciting to compete in such a great competitive series. Hopefully we can make it today.
Good luck, Alex.
Thanks.
All right. And, of course, the most prolific driver in the NASCAR Pinty Series here at Trois-Rivières, Andrew Ranger, leading in championship points. He has four victories, four runner-up finishes. Three runner-up finishes in a row. Can you get over that hump today?
I would like. You know, it's that track. I really like it. Like the race here, and it's always fun to see the fans here. So, you know, since hole seven, I did the worst. It's second position. So we hope to do good today. I think we have the car. The Mopar Penske Lutech car has been awesome. So we tried to do really good today.
These are the three up front. It is an exciting field of drivers. We'll get set to get rolling here at Trois-Rivières right after this.
This NASCAR on TSN telecast from Trois-Rivières, Quebec is brought to you by Mopar, authentic performance. By Leland Industries, a proud Canadian fastener company. By Honeygoo from CleanFlow, a honey of a lube. And by Canadian Blood Services, it's in you to give.
The drivers are strapped in and ready to go here at the Can-Am Le 50 Tour, Dave.
It always gets exciting when you see the grid start to clear on these road courses. That means the crews start to back off, the fans start to back off, and the drivers are in, including Jeffrey Earnhardt.
You're absolutely right. The people almost come off in layers till all that's left are the drivers and their crew chiefs. And now you know those last-minute instructions are being shared.
There is a look at your current points leader, Andrew Ranger. Now let's take a look at how the series has progressed throughout the past seven races. The 2016 Canadian NASCAR season was rebranded with much enthusiasm, the NASCAR Pinty Series. The first of 12 races started at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park. Alex LeBay started the season on a strong note, garnering the pole and leading the race. A late race rain shower, though, had the field struggling for grip. But Andrew Ranger powered his Mopar Dodge into victory lane. Next up, the series moved north to the lightning quick Sunset Speedway. Throughout the 300 lap event, there were seven lead changes by four leaders. Caden Lapcevich held his own at his hometown track, but in the end, it was Alex Tagliani with the win. Next up, the series visited Autodrome Chaudière. The packed house witnessed one of the greatest battles of the season. It was LeBay versus Lapcevich, lap by lap. In the end, the hometown short track hero drove his number 32 to the win. It was Alex LeBay's first NASCAR victory. Circuit ICAR was the second road course on the schedule. 23 cars started the 30-lap race. Alex LeBay showed that he is a championship contender as he hunted down the number 27 Mopar Dodge. Andrew Ranger kept calm and cool and drove to his fourth ICAR win and now had a commanding points lead. The NASCAR Pinty Series returned to the streets of Toronto for its Saturday headlining show. 26 cars dueled for 37 laps. And in the end, it was Alex Tagliani holding off Andrew Ranger in a tough green-white checker finish. The annual Western Swing started off at Edmonton International Raceway. This tough quarter-mile bullring had everyone up on the wheel for the entire 300 laps. The 18 of Tagliani, the least battle-scarred, came out on top in Wetaskiwin. His third win of the season had the Montreal native back into title contention. The NASCAR Pinty Series rolled through the prairies and into Saskatoon for race number 7. This third of a mile dream of a racetrack held court to multiple on-track battles. In a late six-lap shootout, 16-year-old Grimsby, Ontario racer Caden Lapcevich raced his way to his maiden NASCAR victory and now sits just 1 point behind Andrew Ranger in the series points race.
And now let's send it trackside for the official opening ceremonies.
Pour prononcer l'invitation traditionnelle à lancer les moteurs, to pronounce the traditional starting invitation, transportons-nous sur le grand écran pour voir et entendre les militaires trifluviens du 12e régiment stationnés en Pologne.
Bonjour, je suis le lieutenant-colonel Éric Landry, commandant du 12e régiment blindé du Canada, un régiment fondé à Trois-Rivières il y a 145 ans.
Je suis le major Stéphane Clouard, commandant de l'escadron A au régiment à Trois-Rivières. Ladies and gentlemen,
start your engines!
Music to our ears as the field fires up here on the front straightaway as we prepare for the Grand Prix of 2020.
I know, Dave, for our series, that's the first command that's ever been sent from Poland.
Pretty exciting, though, as you see a number of onboard looks for today's race, including Caden Lapcevich, second in points. There's a good look at the Spectra Premium 04 of Dumoulin, hometown hero, looking for his first win.
Gary Clute, driver the number 59. He'd like to get things turned around a little bit. Always good on the road courses.
Boy, he's had some horrible luck so far in 2016. The field prepares to roll. You can see a lot of the dignitaries still on track, just trying to get shuffled off through the wall. But that's the beauty of this place. Walls on both sides.
And as you can see, even on the windshield, as we look out at Jason Hathaway's Robestus number 3, weather has been all around us all weekend, Dave, and it's a big story today as we look at the clean flow starting grid.
Well, we already know who's starting on pole. It's the 74 of Kevin Lacroix, and Tagliani will start alongside Andrew Ranger and Alex LeBay make up row number 2.
Row number 3, Daniel Morad back behind the wheel of the 06 and LP Dumoulin in the WeatherTech 47. In the fourth row is brother Jean-Francois Dumoulin in the 04 and, of course, Gary Clute in the 59.
Having a look at row number 5, a welcome back to Marc-Antoine Cameron, DJ Kennington behind the wheel of the 17. Kerry Mix drives the 02 and David Michaud in the 56 here today. That's row 6.
Row number 7, Simon Dion-Vienne in the 37 and second place in points, Caden Lapcevich in the 76.
Row number 8 is Anthony Simoni in the 95 and Patrick Dussault in the 71.
In the ninth row, Jason Hathaway in the 3 and the 36 of Jeffrey Earnhardt.
He will have a lot of work ahead of him. Jocelyn Fecteau in the 77. Larry Jackson drives the 1. That's row number 10.
And rounding out our starting field, Raymond Guy in the 20 machine and Martin Côté making a series debut.
Cars look beautiful right now. That may not be the case at the end of this race. It's a tight one and it can get pretty physical.
It's a road course that races a lot like a short track to me, Dave. The drivers have to be up on the wheel and super aggressive.
Now let's take a look at our E3 Spark Plugs race analysis.
50 laps, it's just enough to worry these race teams over whether or not they need fuel. Overcast, we've talked about that as well, Dave.
And there are rain tires in the pits, whether or not they have to use them yet to be seen. But if it does rain, it will make it pretty exciting. So before we take the green flag, let's head down pit side once again to Todd and Tanya for today's Leland lead up to the green.
An update on the 17 team before we go green. DJ Kennington has been experiencing back pain all weekend. Visited a chiropractor, it's better, but still an issue. A bigger issue for the team, discovered a problem with the transmission this morning. The clutch wasn't releasing, they've made the change, but by rule on the parade lap, they will fall and start from the back of the field.
Guys, even though he's starting pretty deep in the field, Caden Lapcevich is feeling pretty confident about this race. He likes this circuit better than Toronto, so he's hoping for a top 10 finish.
And as we head for the green flag, Dave, we've seen a lot of mechanical issues in practice. Hopefully we're not going to see it in the race, but the nature of this race course with the hard braking zones and there's a lot of chatter, we've seen bent and broken transmissions, axles, all sorts of things.
Getting ready for the green flag as they head on the front stretch in waves, and we're underway here in 20-fair into turn number 1. Tagliani roughs up the 74 already.
Wow, and he drove it deep down into turn 1. Looked like he might get an advance. Oh, problems already. The 59 of Gary Clute hard into the concrete.
That is a big hit for the Pool Supplies Canada number 59. You can see that waving blue flag in NASCAR. That means a local caution. Now it's going to be a full course caution with a 59 stopped on the racetrack.
Well, and they had to do it. It doesn't look like Gary Klug can get that car fired. He is driver's side exposed to the field when it does get around. But boy, oh boy, just barely got through turn one. Let's have a look towards the top of your screen.
Oh, you see just a touch between him and JF Dumoulin in turn number two, and that was pretty much it. He had no place to go.
That's hard to see. That was wheel-to-wheel contact. Let's see if we get a better look. We're on board now with Jean-Francois Dumoulin. And you say, okay, the accident had already happened. When he gets together with LP Dumoulin, that happened after the crash.
There you see the yellow nose. And there is contact there, but it doesn't appear as though it's that much.
When you touch tire to tire with these race cars, it can do a few things. It can spit the steering wheel out of the driver's hand.
And that's what appears happened. You see the window net is down on the CTL Dodge as we ride on board with Gary Klug. Have a listen.
Tire. It looks to me like the right front of Klug made contact with the left rear tire of the 04 of Dumoulin. Like I say, that'll really spit a car in any which direction.
And I mentioned the window net being down on the 59. That's the driver's indication that he is okay. So we continue under caution here in 20 Pierre. Welcome back to Trois-Rivières, Quebec, in race number 8 on the 2016 NASCAR Pinty Series schedule, Le Cinq en Tour, presented by Can-Am. So it's a complete restart, minus the cars involved. Essentially, that's minus Gary Klug.
Yeah, tough for Gary Klug. On the original start, Kevin Lacroix got a good early jump. It looked like Tagliani was trying to squeeze him as far as he could towards the inside of turn one to give himself a better run. Let's see if he can do it again, Dave.
Green flag once again waves, and this time it is all Kevin Lacroix down the front chute. He'll lead them into turn number one.
And that was a pretty early departure for Lacroix, but it got him into turn one, free and clear of the 18.
More importantly, it gets the rest of the field pretty much single file in through turn number two and down towards the Duplessis gates.
They work down into turn three. This is not a place you want to be side by side, and you can really see them checking up, doing what they have to do to not get involved with the cars around them.
That is so tight through turn number three, and then you get to flex your muscle here down the back straightaway.
And down towards turn six, where we're going to see the cars wiggle all day long under extreme braking.
And the risk here when you're under that hard braking, that downshift, is the wheel hop. You get those back wheels hopping when you're downshifting and you've lost it. It's essentially like pulling your e-brake on your streetcar.
And it'll spin you around, but what else it'll do, as we spoke earlier, right now we're on board with LP Dumoulin and the WeatherTech 47. It really causes a lot of stress on the rear axles, the drivetrain. Spoke about DJ Kennington having to change transmissions. Three different teams broke the input shaft on transmissions this weekend alone.
See Andrew Ranger putting some pressure on your second place driver, the EpiPen Chevy of Alex Tagliani. Now we'll look back from Tagliani, the Mopar Dodge of Andrew Ranger. Look at how much the front end of these cars work as they're under braking and through the corners.
You're about to see these cars work real hard down into six, and this is where I love watching Andrew Ranger go to work.
See, even an experienced road course driver like Andrew Ranger has to correct just a little bit under braking.
That turn, the entry of turn six here at Trois-Rivières, is the most fun for me to watch of any turn on our circuit.
Ranger seems to be closing that gap on the back end of the EpiPen Riobel number 18 of Alex Tagliani. Good look at his tire marks on his door. That's from that opening lap rub going into turn number one with the 74 of Kevin Lacroix. One driver who's out of this one early is the 59, Todd, standing by with him.
Yeah, guys, we caught up with Gary Klug, who's just come out of the infield medical center, giving the okay. Describe what happened, if you can, on that opening lap.
I'm not sure who it was. I haven't seen the TV yet, but it looked like the 04 or the 56 just came right down. I was on the inside, and we're at Trois-Rivières. There's a wall there.
Second year in a row, Gary Klug is a victim.
Yeah, frustrating.
Frustrating indeed, but he still manages to smile. Remember, he's part of the NASCAR Next group, and he has his sights set up the NASCAR ladder.
He's got a lot to look forward to. Of course, next week he'll be down at Riverside International with the Pinty Series, but when we go back to Canadian Tire Motorsport Park, Dave, he's got some bigger sights set there.
Well, he's already purchased a Camping World truck, and he'll be doing a couple rent-a-rides as well, so big news out of the Clute camp for the future of his NASCAR racing career.
And Gary's got a great mindset to be successful in racing. He's got good, solid backing, but he doesn't seem to let things bother him too much either. He's just got the right headspace, although it hasn't been great for him the last 2 years here. He went out of this race on exactly the same lap in exactly the same spot.
Riding on board the 04 of J.F. Dumoulin, the car that made contact with the 59 of Gary Clute. You see no damage done to the Spectra Premium Dodge Challenger.
Dave, once again, I'm going to remind you how much fun it is to stand and watch the same race with you and see something totally different. There's significant damage on the left front corner of the 04 machine. We would have just seen it coming into the screen. From the driver's seat, the hood seems fine, but the left front fender and the left front side of that hood is exposed, and the more air you put into there, the more it wants to rip everything right to pieces.
It's a little bit of fiberglass damage. The wheels are all pointed in the right direction, which is what I meant after making contact with the 59 of Gary Clute. Looks like the 04 is working along trouble-free.
From a speed standpoint, he's doing just fine. When you can run on a road course right between LP Dumoulin and Marc-Antoine Cameron, your car is performing fairly well, but certainly they'll have their eyes on the damage to the 04 machine.
And Adam, I'll agree with you there. Sitting in seventh spot, or at least a battle for seventh with the 99 of Marc-Antoine Cameron, is J.F. Dumoulin. So up towards the front of the field, but there is your race leader, the bumper-to-bumper Total Lubricants, number 74 of Kevin Lacroix.
And you could see in that shot, you don't really see it on the in-car, but the windshield wiper is installed on the 74, Dave, in case they need it.
They haven't yet. Kevin Lacroix still out in front after 11 laps. Still under green flag conditions as we welcome you back to the Sanquin Tour presented by Can-Am here at the Grand Prix of Trois-Rivières.
Things have settled down just a little bit at the front of the field, but look further back, Dave. It is frantic right now.
That's a good look at a battle for 12th spot between the 76 of Caden Lapcevic, the 71 of Patrick Dussault. They are going at it quite hard.
And they've got Hewitt's on board for three races, and that car, since the last time we saw it in Toronto, was rebuilt almost from the windshield forward. White Motorsports, and of course, Bruno Goyette, a big part of the rebuild of that race car. Looks to be doing okay. They were having some braking issues all day long yesterday.
Now, if you remember, Dussault ran into a lot of trouble at the Toronto Indy Track, the exhibition place. He kept bouncing off walls on either side, and the car was pretty torn up, but it looks good. New paint scheme with Hewitt Cat on board, and it's going well.
We're riding along with Jason Hathaway in the Robestos number 3. Listen to him downshift into turn 6.
Look at Caden Lapcevic, who is slowly, quietly coming into his own as a really solid, consistent road course driver in the series.
You know, he's doing so very well. And we just saw the 95 of Simone go by, Dave, and I swear, yeah, he's pushing steam out the windshield, the hose that comes up along the windshield that comes out of the radiator. So when these cars start to overheat, it'll shoot water up the windshield and kind of notify the driver, just in case he doesn't see the water temperature gauge, hey, you've got a pretty significant problem.
Some of them have a light on the dash as well that would indicate a high temperature, and Simone, now at a last resort, will have to look out the window and see that water poking up. So he stayed out on track, did not pit that time, past pit lane, so the 95 still out there and still pushing some steam.
And talking about the 76, Caden Lapcevic comes into this race just 1 point behind Andrew Ranger. And all year long, they've done so very well. They're more confident on the oval tracks. But this had to be a date they had circled on their calendar. This is not a race where you're looking to gain points on Andrew Ranger. This is a race where you're looking to minimize the points you might lose to Andrew Ranger. The worst Ranger has ever finished here at Trois-Rivières is second in 9 races.
And they're working through lap traffic as they go by the 11 of Martin Côté in the GoVR Dodge. Côté making his first start in the NASCAR Pinty Series from Sheffield, Quebec.
And he's having a blast this weekend. But one final point on Caden Lapcevic. They want to advance their position, but they want to stay out of trouble. Right now, this is the last thing they want. A couple drivers behind him who are not racing for points and who are showing their nose at every opportunity.
And are very hungry. Simon Gionvien in the number 37 has joined that battle. You see, just in behind is the Ray Bestis Brakes number 3 of Jason Hathaway. So this soon could become a 4-car dice.
Well, it may very well. And again, these three Quebecois drivers, the Dumoulin brothers and Marc-Antoine Cameron, are duking it out, and there's still water coming out of the 95.
Yeah, look at his go as he goes by. The innovative plumbing, number 95 of Anthony Simone, currently sitting in 11th spot. It's a great return. That car was working very, very well in Toronto. Unfortunately, had problems. It caught fire. They got it fixed. They were really looking forward to this race because it's a similar track.
Yeah, the innovative plumbing 95, Simone there. And the way that hose is pointed is almost out the side of the car. I worry he might not be able to see that, Dave.
Patrick Dussault once again takes a look underneath the 76 of Caden Lapcevic. Lapcevic will hold him off once again.
I would swear Caden just went to reach for his shifter and he missed. Did you see? It looked like his hand moved twice.
He possibly slipped off it. He doesn't have a knob at the top of it, so he's grabbing it. It's sort of the handgun style of the old shifter knobs.
And they've all got a slightly different variation, but some of them do like that grip. We saw the black flag being displayed. We're hearing over the officials' radio the 95 of Simone is being black flagged to come and address his overheating problem.
Well, you don't want to be dumping fluid out on the racetrack. They're going to try and keep this event green, and it is currently under green flag conditions. We'll remind you, your leader is the 74 of Kevin Lacroix, comfortably out in front. The 18 of Alex Tagliani running second. The 27 of Andrew Ranger holding down third.
Caden Lapcevic driving down the inside of the racetrack to prevent Patrick Dussault from getting a run. Maybe he missed a bit of a shift or didn't get out of the last turn as well as he wanted, but he's had the foresight to run the bottom of the racetrack to make sure he didn't give up a spot.
Dussault is looking every which way to get by the number 76. Rookie of the Year contender, Caden Lapcevic, and there goes the number 95 of Anthony Simone. He'll head to pit lane to try and fix those problems.
And Simone Dionvien starting to show pressure as well. So Patrick Dussault, who doesn't need a lot of help being aggressive, might step it up a notch.
As the 95 heads into the pits, Todd's there. Todd?
Steam had been visible on the windshield of that 95 car for a while. They're going to refuel, get some tape off the front. Anthony Simone was having troubles hearing the crew, and that's why it took him so long to make his way to pit road.
And there goes the hood pins. The hood is going to come up on that Dodge Challenger. It's not just tape. They're going to take a look at for other problems under the hood.
So of all the means they have for a driver to know that he's overheating, one are his gauges, two is the dummy hose that comes up the windshield, and three is your crew to call you in. Well, if the hose was going out the side of the car and you can't hear your crew, we don't know if the gauges were working right or not either, Dave.
Now you see Don Thompson Jr. taking a look from his pit box and watching his driver, Kevin Lacroix, command the field here in Trois-Rivières. Lacroix still leads. And there you see it, heartbreak for the number 71 of Patrick Dussault. Smoke coming from the left-hand side of that Dodge Challenger.
It's not a flat tire. It almost looks like the suspension has collapsed on the left front corner of that race car.
The Hewitt-Cat Dussault Construction Dodge was up in 13th position. You saw him battling with the 76 of Caden Lapcevic. Here's what happened.
So the left front, you can see. Oh, you can't see it. Okay,
there
it collapsed. And again, the tire is inflated because it's still inflated now. So it has collapsed onto the suspension of that race car.
The 71 of Patrick Dussault will limp his way around this track and into pit lane as he finds his way through that tight pit road opening into his crew owned by Patrick Brisebois. They were looking for big things, but the 74 of Kevin Lacroix nearly caught a wall.
Cut that close. I've been watching for a number of laps. Some of them like to run right up to the outside wall and use as much of the track as they can. But I have to think that might have been a bit of a slip by Kevin Lacroix. That was too close.
And we should mention, too, that the number 95 of Anthony Simone is officially out of competition. The belt on the oil pump, the problem on that car.
Oh, what a horrible break for Simone as we look at the 71 Patrice Brisebois-owned race car, and one of the crewmen is waving it off. I believe the left front suspension, I believe something broken there, that the wheel wouldn't stay in one position.
And you can see the wheel pushed up inside the fender, but Fred Harden, one of the crew members there, working to try and get that wheel out, but it looks like they may end their day early as well.
Long-time crewman Fred Harden. He's been on a number of race teams. Definitely one you want going over the wall if you're racing in this series, Dave.
Back at the front of the field, it is Lacroix out front, as we mentioned, but this is still a battle for second spot, and it's still the 18 of Alex Taglianni ahead of the Mopar Dodge of Andrew Ranger.
You know, we're five laps from the halfway point of this race, Dave, and it reminds me of the events we've seen at Circuit ICAR, where Kevin Lacroix goes out and he's the rabbit. We're seeing Taglianni and Ranger keep him within their sights. He has driven away, but not to a great extent. So they're kind of keeping him within check, but they're going to have to get a move on at some point.
But there's the risk, too. If you start pushing too hard, you wear out your tires, you wear out your brakes, and you need those for the last few laps of this race. So you can't wear it out too early. There you see Anthony Simone out of the car and taking off the helmet.
Such disappointment for Anthony. It'll be a long ride home for sure. And look how big the gap is from third back to Alex LeBay, who we're now on board with, running in the fourth position.
And you may think you're seeing double at times during this race with the 32 of Alex LeBay in the Can-Am-sponsored Ford Fusion and the 36 of Jeffrey Earnhardt in the Can-Am-sponsored Ford Fusion. They're nearly identical except for the numbers. Of course, LeBay started up front. Earnhardt started out back, but Earnhardt is coming.
You know, he's really enjoying his time here. I got to talk to him during practice yesterday. His frustration is he has not gotten as much practice as he wanted. Again, a mechanical failure. That car prepared out of the Dave Jacobs shop, so it's well prepared, but something broke. They had to fix it in practice. He only got three laps on the track in the final practice session.
Good battle between a couple of brothers in front of a hometown crowd. Of course, Dumoulin Competition is based out of Trois-Rivières, Quebec. You have LP Dumoulin in the 47, the WeatherTech Dodge, and the Spectra Premium 04 of JF Dumoulin. They're nose to tail right now, currently in seventh spot. Battle for seventh spot. JF to the inside of his brother LP. LP with a win here in Trois-Rivières, Quebec, back in his championship run season of 2014.
Call me crazy, Dave, but we're seeing a little bit more of the hood on the 04 than we did earlier, particularly in that in-car shot. You can see it lifting up just a little bit. At some point, it's going to catch enough wind that it'll just shear right off.
And it will probably catch it right here down the back straightaway as we ride on board the WeatherTech.ca Dodge.
Shifting into turn number six, and we should mention, because we don't want to get the good folks at NASCAR upset, they are tethered. The hoods of these cars are tethered. Any piece they feel could fly off and cause a danger are tethered. The R&D Center's done a great job with putting those sort of controls on these cars.
And speaking of the R&D Center, there's a data recorder you see right beside the MSD ignition box. That data recorder has been placed there by NASCAR in select cars. Goes from car to car, different cars for select races, but it's all in the effort to collect data from these race cars in hopes of learning more about them and making them better, safer, and lasting longer on the racetrack.
And I believe this week we've got them in the 74 of Lacroix and in the 47 of Dumoulin.
There's a battle for ninth spot, the 76, Caden Lapcevich, and the 37 of Simon Zion-Vienne. And not too far behind the Ray Vestis Brakes Fast Eddie Racewear number 3 of Jason Hathaway.
And he's been closing on this battle for the last 15 minutes, Dave, picking up half a car length a lap. But I think now that he gets within closing distance, he might step it up a notch, maybe get a little bit of a toe down the straightaway.
And down the straightaway they go. Lapcevich with Simon Zion-Vienne in the draft. Will he pull out? Not this time. He'll tuck in line. They'll both break and downshift in through turn number 6.
And as I said, that Hathaway is off the pace. He's lost some ground.
Very, very slow in the Chevrolet. Have a listen.
The car sounds fine.
You can hear him bumping the gas and bringing up the revs, but obvious problems on board the number 3 of Jason Hathaway. He'll be looking for the pits this time by.
I would imagine he's going to bring it down pit lane to the attention of Craig Masters and the crew.
Now, if you remember at Circuit ICAR, the number three team had problems with their rear axle, so potentially that could be an issue here again.
Yeah, it's not often you see that.
There it is.
That's exactly what it is. The right rear axle has spit. Man, that's 2 feet out of the rear hub.
Yeah, so good on Jason Hathaway for feeling something wrong as he'll find his pits and they'll try and get that fixed, but no doubt he'll go laps down.
Terrible, Brian. I just can't imagine the bad luck that Jason Hathaway has had each and every race so far this year.
Leaders going around, the number one of Larry Jackson in the Canadian Blood Services sponsored Dodge. Now, Larry is racing with a heavy heart here today, celebrating the life of Julia McQuinn, who recently passed away. She would have been just 13 years old this week, had over 100 blood transfusions. When we say it's in you to give, it's very important to give blood.
And you know, Dave, Larry wasn't going to race this weekend. With the passing of Julia, she's a very close friend of their daughter, Larry Jackson, his wife's daughter. They watched her go to slumber parties together. You know, they've watched them grow up together in such a sad, sad week. We said, you know what, if I can bring the car out and encourage anyone to give blood, that's what I'm going to do. And here he is racing this weekend.
Well, pit road is becoming busy with some early retirements. Todd and Tanya are standing by. Todd?
Jason Hathaway out of the car, a strange one, but that's kind of been the way for you at times this season.
Yeah, it's been the way our season's been all year. I don't know. We keep buying new parts and keep breaking new parts. So it's, you know, not the guy's fault, not the team's fault, not the driver's fault. It's just another broken part for another weekend. So kind of tough. I enjoy racing here a lot, and, you know, you don't want to go to this event, especially that early.
Thanks, Jason.
Thanks.
Okay, Gary, tell me what happened on track.
You know, it's one of those deals. We had a steering box issue there a couple races ago, and we fixed, technical anyways, fixed the sector shaft in it, a seal, and I guess we should have replaced, put a new box in, and the seal just went again. We had an awesome car. Got to thank Johnsonville, Leland, and Avenue Auto Parts and everybody else that helps us, the crew, you know, just a bad day, just really disappointed. We worked all weekend really hard, the crew did, and got the car where it needed to be. We were just driving around it there. We had a really good car, so we were gonna go forward later in the race. Just one of those things.
Tough break for the 0-2 coming off a top five finish in Toronto, but they'll regroup and they'll be back at Riverside.
You know, and it was fun to see Kerry Mick so competitive. That team did work hard yesterday, made a lot of changes, but they've made a lot of gains in that program, and I love seeing the spark back in Kerry's eyes, knowing that he's close enough to make a move.
And there you can see the NASCAR data recorder that we talked about a little bit earlier, the red box alongside the MSD box there on the dash of the 74 of Kevin Lacroix. He's looking out his windshield and seeing nobody. That's because the 74 is still out front. Welcome back to Le Sengon Tour, presented by Can-Am. I'm Dave Bradley. Along with me is Adam Ross. Todd Lewis and Tanya Baudet are patrolling the pits for us here in Trois-Rivières, Quebec, as Kevin Lacroix continues to lead, but we're watching this battle for ninth spot between Caden Lapcevic and the 37 of Simon Zion-Vienne.
Caden Lapcevic has not had a restful lap this entire race. It was Patrick Dussault applying the pressure, and now Dion Vienne applying the pressure as well.
And Dion wants to give the oval tracks a try too, so he's sniffing around. He may do a couple races in the near future, but he's started to get a hold of these road course races. We've seen him a number of times in the NASCAR Pinty series, and he's starting to gain some speed as he goes for a slide and into the back of the 76.
Wow! Spins the car out, didn't make contact with anything, but that car was about 3 feet up in the air.
Caution flag is out, a full course caution. Look at the torn up nose of the 37 of Simon Dion-Vienne. We'll have another look at this.
So he's closing in a couple of car lengths back. Something broke, Dave.
Or possibly wheel hop. You're downshifting, you're hard on the brakes, the back wheels start hopping, and you lose control.
And the only way to get it back from a wheel hop is to actually let off the brakes, and that might have been it. But boy, the closing rate on that 37 was crazy.
Now, Caden Lapcevic got very, very lucky there. He did not make contact with the back wall, but he comes into this one just 1 point back of Andrew Ranger for the points lead in the NASCAR Pinty Series.
So his father, Jeff Lapsevich, who's also the crew chief, down there orchestrating what they're going to do should the 76 come to pit road. And we look at the heavy damage on the front of the number 37 Wholesale Express car.
Yeah, the Best Buy Dodge pretty torn up. Again, have another look. This is the end of it. And it's where Dion Vienne comes into contact with that tire wall into turn number one. On board, Lapsevich.
And this is right where he gets it. Wow. Big impact. You can see him lock it down, immediately reaches for the starter to refire that car. Unfortunate, he was able to back up, didn't lose a lap, and catch up to the field.
NASCAR safety team on site in their Dodge safety trucks. You can see the waving blue flags, the net down on Simon Dion Vienne, so he is okay. You can even see the belts loosened. So he's moving around inside the cockpit of that car.
That's for sure a good sign. And let's get a good look at the back end of the number 76. Yeah, you don't see a whole lot of damage on it, but Dion Vienne went right underneath. And what you would be worried about, that's where the fuel cell is, and it's well protected. But if you punch a hole in that fuel cell, your day is done.
And also, when you lift up the back tires, they drop back down, you run the risk of some drivetrain problems, either rear end gear, transmission. Should mention that Caden Lapsevich, once he refired and he found his way back in line, he's sitting in 12th spot. So he really didn't lose that much ground.
No, right behind Jeffrey Earnhardt in the 36 as he passes by the scene of the crime. And the big problem, we talked about mechanical failures. Lapsevich did break a rear axle yesterday in practice, so they had to change things out of that race car.
See Patrick Dussault in the number 71 has rejoined the field after his earlier troubles. So shockingly, they were able to make the repairs they needed to make in the left front corner of their Dodge Challenger, and he's back on track.
These teams are pretty resilient, and if nothing else, it's great track time. And of course, it's good to promote his new sponsor, Hewitt Rentals.
Indeed, the Can-Am getting a good shot here. Of course, Can-Am presenting today's Le Cinquante Tour at the Grand Prix de Trois-Rivières. And what a party this city puts on for this event. When we say a race comes to town and it's a party, they really take hold of it here in Trois-Rivières, Quebec.
There really is no event in Canada quite like the Grand Prix de Trois-Rivières. Saturday night, last night, where is everybody? They're downtown because the whole town shuts down for the fireworks show as well, Dave.
Oh, he had some fireworks on the track, but we'll stack him back up and head back to green. Welcome back to Trois-Rivières, Quebec, in race number 8 of the NASCAR Pinty Series in 2016. Kevin Lacroix is your race leader as we prepare to go back to green. The 37 machine of Simon Dion Vienne on the back of the flatbed hauler headed for pit lane.
And Simon Dion Vienne is with Todd Lewis.
Simon, glad to see that you're okay. What happened out there?
Yeah, one part of the suspension broke in front of the car. I was very, very easy on the car, follow Lapsevich, and something broke in front of the car. So that's bad. The car was very good. All my sponsors are in Trois-Rivières, Wholesale Express, Best Buy Auto Park, Kamouraska, Chrysler, Castrol, all the guys are here. I want to do a good show, but it's bad. But The car is pretty bad, I think. So.
Glad to see you're okay.
Restart number 2 is the green flag sent away once again. And look at Lacroix and Tagliani on the front straightaway. Here comes Ranger 3 wide.
Lacroix was worried about Tags. Here comes Ranger to the bottom. Tagliani way up out of the groove.
Up in that gray asphalt outside of the rubber mark on the inside of turn 1. We all stay straight. And believe it or not, we're still green, and now we're spreading out going into turn number 3. That's not a wise move.
You can't even go 2 wide through there, and they're trying to go 3 wide, Dave.
But the change at the front, the 27 of Andrew Ranger now in second spot. And did you see the front fender of the 04 machine? But have another look at this restart.
Well, Tagliani is pressuring Lacroix to the side of the track. Lacroix just fought back, but he was so far ahead of the 18 that it actually hooked him, almost spun him around in front of the field.
Lacroix not willing to be pushed around. He maintains the lead, and now he has Andrew Ranger on his back bumper as he slides it through the corner. No doubt the adrenaline is pumping in the veins of the 74 machine.
Well into the second half of this race, it's now time with the restart. It's time for Ranger and Tagliani to show what they've got, and if they have anything for the 74, this is when they want to be close.
How about the NSYNC 06 of Daniel Morat? We haven't talked a lot about that driver. He did very well
in Toronto in front of his home fans for his second start in the NASCAR Pinty Series. He's showing very well once again here today.
That's another car prepared by Dave Jacobs. You've got the 32 of LeBay, the 06 of Morad, and of course the 36 of Earnhardt, all showing very well.
Drivers are starting to push, though. You saw the back end step out on the EpiPen number 18 of Alex Tagliani. He gathers it back up. The veteran does and holds on to third place.
Down into turn number six. That's where Ranger closes the gap on whoever is running ahead of him. Now they're going to go on board.
Saw the shot back from the 74 of Kevin Lacroix, back to the 27 of Andrew Ranger, and then back out the front windshield of the Mopar Dodge. But this is a carbon copy of what we saw last year, except reversed. So is Lacroix doing the chase of the 27 of Andrew Ranger?
Absolutely the reverse of last year. And in that long shot, I swear I saw smoke coming off of one of the cars further back in the top 10, but I don't see it now from the overhead, Dave.
Well, you saw the fender flapping on the 04 Spectra Premium Dodge of JF Dumoulin last time he went by. There it is. And you talked about it earlier, the wind catching that fiberglass bodywork, and it's starting to take its toll.
It's not easy being right so often, Dave, but next to you, it just feels easy.
We should give you a trophy every time you're right.
That'll be all right. Now we're on board with JF Dumoulin again. The hood seems to be holding place where it's been. And the fender will probably be fine. It's probably not going anywhere, but cosmetically, not very pleasant to look at.
Not really, but he's chasing the number 32 Can-Am Ford Fusion of Alex LeBay. You can see them all tucked into a tight line, chasing the 18 of Alex Tagliani. Daniel Morad also in that group.
I wonder if the contact between Tagliani and Kevin Lacroix going down into turn one might have bent the suspension on the 18, because he is falling back into the grips of all the cars behind him.
And the 99 in trouble in pit lane. Marc-Antoine Cameron finds his pit stall, and the crew will go to work still under green, so he's losing lots of ground.
Ah, terrible for Marc-Antoine Cameron. As many podium finishes at Trois-Rivières as any driver in history.
Well, as we prepare to bring you to the finish, we'll be back. There you see a good shot of the leaders. Kevin Lacroix ahead of the 27 of Andrew Ranger and the 18 of Alex Tagliani. But look at this, a little bit deeper in the field. Jeffrey Earnhardt a little crossways as the Castrol Edge Dodge, the 17 of DJ Kennington, closes.
Those are some pretty darn good race cars he's got behind him. Kennington, LP Dumoulin, Caden Lapcevich. So Jeffrey Earnhardt really getting right at home in these Pinty Series stock cars.
Earnhardt sitting in seventh position. The 17 car Kennington just behind him in eighth. And then the 47 of Dumoulin running in ninth. They have to look back. Those two cars have won. The 17 of Kennington and the 47 of Dumoulin both have reached victory lane here in Trois-Rivières.
And even more impressive, DJ Kennington and the 17 started dead last when they changed transmission on that race car. They had to drop to the back of the field for the green flag.
And he's still searching for his first win of 2016, but here is a good place for the 17 team. Five top fives, an average finish of seventh.
It's going to take something pretty spectacular to happen at the front of this field for him to have a shot today, but definitely looking pretty racy out there, Dave.
And look who's catching them, the 76 of young Caden Lapcevich. He is coming back after that mishap with Simon Zielvien.
The 04 of Dumoulin was on pit road. Jean-Francois Dumoulin coming into the pit.
Lots of fiberglass flapping on the 04, and the crew going to work with Beyerbohn to try to repair it so that they can get approval from the NASCAR officials that they are good to go and return to the action.
And it was indeed that fender. NASCAR officials coming over and telling us that he did receive the black flag for that fender flapping.
Whoa, Daniel Morad. Turn six is called a turn for a reason. He goes straight through the runoff.
Luckily for a runoff area, see him smoking the brakes and the tires as he tries to get the car woed, manages to take the runoff, avoids the wall. He'll get it righted and back in this race.
It's a split-second decision the driver has to make, and he's just got that one moment to do it. You either try to turn left and stuff it in the tire wall or go straight off the runoff, spin the car around, and get back on the racetrack.
Now, you remember, he was in the top five. He's currently in the ninth position, so he got back in line fairly quickly. Just behind this group here continues to battle nose-to-tail, Jeffrey Earnhardt in the Kappa Can-Am number 36, and here comes Kennington.
Well, and Earnhardt now the fifth-place driver. Great job to go from 18th all the way up to 5th with just 10 laps to go.
Interesting on that 17, you see the tags of orange tape on the windshield of DJ Kennington. That's so his spotter, Don Reinhardt, can actually see him.
When all these cars are coming straight at you, you need something to make yours look different. And we just had a great look. His car, at quick glance, doesn't look a whole lot different than the 32 or the 36 from the front.
The sound of the engines on these cars as they head down the back straightaway. That was on board from Caden Lapcevic, who's now tucked up underneath the back bumper, the 47, the WeatherTech Dodge of LV Dumoulin.
And Jeffrey Earnhardt holding off some stiff competition as he works his way around the racetrack, doing a great job. These are much, much different than the Sprint Cup Series cars he's used to driving.
Well, they're not quite as high-tech. They might look the same on the outside. If you take the bodies off both the machines, these cars have a lot less horsepower, and they're not so high-tech underneath. The brakes aren't quite as adequate, and the shock packages are not quite as high-tech. Not as expensive either, so it's a little bit more economical, but here comes Kennington to the inside now.
Down into turn number one, DJ on the inside of Jeffrey Earnhardt. He'll get the position. Can Earnhardt close the door on Dumoulin?
Looks like he will. Dumoulin unable to get to the inside. Now into turn number three. Will Dumoulin try it? He pulls up to the rear corner, and they will go side by side. Earnhardt's going to slide it off of turn number three.
Nobody told Jeffrey Earnhardt, you can't go through that turn on the outside. Did a nice job, but it looks like he's going to lose two spots.
Yeah, it's going to cost him huge as Lapcevic now into turn number six under braking will pick up that position.
Nice job by both LP Dumoulin and Caden Lapcevic to capitalize on the hole that DJ Kennington made, getting around Earnhardt, and immediately Kennington starts to drive away.
At the front of the field, though, Kevin Lacroix continues to lead. Now the gap at the front, about a second and a half over the 27 of Andrew Ranger, but this battle still going strong. Dumoulin struggling a little bit with the WeatherTech number 47.
That car just does not agree with him. It's really loose going into that corner. Lapcevic right up on the rear deck.
To go from starter Sean Gibbs, and this battle here will likely heat up in these final 10 laps here in Trois-Rivières, Quebec.
Great view of DJ Kennington opening up about 15 car lengths out in front of Dumoulin, and Caden Lapcevic, if he's going to make his move, he needs to do it soon.
Taking a look as the cars weave their way through turn number three in those Duplessis gates, that's really the historic corner on this racetrack. They love to take pictures of the cars coming through those gates just because it's so tight and it's so picturesque. But here's Morad to the inside of Earnhardt.
Daniel Morad with the preferred groove on the inside, working his way back towards the front.
And remember, Daniel Morad is doing double duty here this weekend once again, running the Porsche GT3 Cup Challenge Canada and then jumping into a Pinty Series car, so it takes a little bit of time to acclimatize.
You know, the other driver who's driven a number of race cars is Alex Tagliani. He's two podium finishes into the weekend already.
Not bad. He's trying to make it another one here in the NASCAR Pinty Series, but your leader has this one well in hand as he looks to get around the number 11 of Martin Cote, and he will do so without a problem down the back straightaway.
Martin Cote doing a really nice job. He's not the fastest car on the track this weekend, but there's not even a mark on that 11 car. Big smile on his face, and he's learned an awful lot.
has to be frustrating for the driver of the Mopar Dodge, Andrew Ranger, who's pretty much had his way with any competition he's faced here in the past at Trois-Rivières, Quebec. And today, he really hasn't had enough to catch the 74 of Kevin Lacroix.
Every onboard we've seen with Andrew Ranger is now we ride on board with Lacroix. He's looked busy inside the race car. Not huge movements on the steering wheel, but always working. We're getting down to the finish at Trois-Rivières.
Seven-year-old Kevin Lacroix continues to lead race number 8 of the NASCAR Pinty Series here in Trois-Rivières, Quebec, giving chase is the number 27 of Andrew Ranger.
He's kept him in his sights, Dave, but he just can't reel him in to make a move.
Ranger, a two-time series champion, and look at this. Deeper in the field, the 76 of Caden Lapcevich, and trying to get around the 47 of LP Dumoulin, a battle for sixth spot.
You know, one point we should illustrate as Daniel Morehead closing in on that battle is that Andrew Ranger is not yet led a lap today, so no bonus point to Ranger, so right now they still are separated by just one point.
And you have to think, too, that caution and the incident that the 76 of Lapcevich was involved with looks to have helped him, actually, because it bunched the field in front of him, allowed him to catch up. He didn't lose too many positions, and now he's able to gain some ground.
Now you can't really argue with that as he's battling for the sixth spot. And what I mean by just one point between Ranger and Lapcevich, of course, the race isn't over. If it did end right now, there'd be a five-point gap because Lapcevich is four positions behind Ranger, but there's no damage done yet.
The NSYNC 06 of Daniel Morehead took a look on the 76. The Grimsby youngster, Caden Lapcevich, trying to hold off a hungry Toronto native and Daniel Morehead.
That sixth, seventh, eighth position, Jeffrey Earnhardt has faded back just a little bit in the ninth spot as the laps wind down, just seven laps to go.
You know what's interesting is you can look through the front windshield of the 47 of LP Dumoulin. He's got white gloves on, and you can see his hands working, and boy, are they busy.
Everybody is. You know, at the top of the show, we talked about Trois-Rivières. This street circuit is a road course that races like a short track. You've really got to muscle the cars around as we look at Caden Lapcevich. Same thing, sawing on that steering wheel just a bit.
The tires screaming for traction, almost at the 50 lap distance now. These Goodyears, pretty much all of the good is gone out of them.
And look at that train in front of him. He's running right now, what, in the sixth position. That's a lot of points he could pick up if he can make a couple of passes here, Dave.
But he has to remember to keep his nose clean. He cannot afford a DNF here in Trois-Rivières, Quebec, as the field moving past the 77 of Jocelyn Fichteau.
Tight quarters racing right here as LP Dumoulin shoots across the racetrack under acceleration. Caden Lapcevich looking to the outside into turn one.
Oh, and he leans on the 47 of Dumoulin. They're going to go side by side through turn number one.
I don't think Dumoulin expected the young racer to really mount that challenge, but he did, and he made it work.
He put it on the line and sticks it as Lapcevich picks up a spot. You saw the 06 of Daniel Morehead take a look on the outside. But, of course, Caden Lapcevich cut his racing teeth on a short track where he had to run the inside and the outside, and he put that to good use there.
Dumoulin was running the inside of the straightaway, and then he moved up to the top, and it opened the door for Morehead. He'll make the pass in turn six.
Morehead, an uncontested pass in the NSYNC 06 as he continues his track forward. Have another look at this pass by Caden Lapcevich.
Who got into who there, Dave?
They got together, let's just put it that way, and then they drag race side by side.
And that's a tough spot to do. The outside of turn number two, that's pretty much no man's land.
So everybody has settled down now, chasing the 17 of DJ Kennington. Of course, Kevin Lacroix in the 74 is still your race leader with a significant berth out front.
On board with LP Dumoulin, he's been a busy, busy driver. That car is not doing the things he wants it to do as we see him drive down into turn number one, a huge crowd on hand.
But you know what? Sometimes when you don't have the pressure either in front of you or behind you, it allows you to take a step back to cool things off, and it may help you in the long run.
Well, you never never know, but the long run is pretty much here as we got five laps remaining, and Lacroix still using every inch of racetrack.
See in the shot previous to this one, it really is a two-horse race at the front of the field. You've got Lacroix in the bumper-to-bumper Total Lubricants number 74, and you've got Ranger in the Mopar Dodge number 27 holding down second. Alex Taglianni not far behind, but not really close enough to mount a challenge right now.
Not close enough to challenge, and looking at the lap times, Andrew Ranger will pick up a tenth of a second one lap, but Kevin Lacroix will get it back the next. So the two drivers running very similar lap times.
Down the back straightaway, and this top three is the same group that did battle in Toronto, and the same three drivers that finished on the podium the last time we had a street course race in 2016 here in the NASCAR Pinty Series.
Three top shelf drivers, three top notch crew chiefs, Don Thompson Jr., Dave White, and Tyler Case, first, second, and third. That's what you need, Dave. Everything's got to come together from the team, the car, and of course, the driver.
When you're Andrew Ranger, though, now, you know you've got just over four laps to go. Do you sit back and enjoy where you are in second spot, or do you continue to pressure and go?
I don't think Andrew Ranger became Andrew Ranger by sitting back. I mean, at the end of the race, they might do an interview at all. I'm happy with second, but right now, he's out there to win.
On board the EpiPen Cantor number 18 of Alex Taglianni. How about Alex LeBay in the 32? He's had a quietly solid day in that Can-Am Ford Fusion. Not a mark on the car and sitting in fourth spot.
Doing a great job as Alex LeBay. And you know, as I talk about Ranger being happy with second, in Toronto, that was the first time I've ever seen Andrew Ranger satisfied with second after that battle he had with Taglianni.
Yeah, usually he's a very, very disappointed, just a fiery competitor here in NASCAR.
Oh, my goodness!
That's your race leader who almost caught the tire wall in turn number six.
He missed that turn by a mile, Dave.
And was it ever close to the tire? Have another look on board the 74 Kevin Lacroix.
And you can see he missed the apex of the front end, just plowed up the racetrack. I don't know how he made that car turn before he got sucked into the tire wall.
Listen to the chatter. And there you can see the back end bouncing on that Dodge Challenger. How did he get that turned in time?
And is something broke on it? Like, something has to cause that. When you hit your mark 37 times in a row and then on the 38th time, all of a sudden you miss?
But now the 27 of Andrew Ranger could not capitalize. That was a mishap, a rare misstep from the 74 of Kevin Lacroix during this race. And the 27 of Ranger, that has to be super frustrating. You saw it happen, and you're unable to capitalize.
Two more laps around this famed Trois-Rivières street circuit for Kevin Lacroix. He has led every lap so far.
And this, now a battle for fifth spot between the 17, the Castrol Edge Dodge of DJ Kennington, the 76 of Caden laps of it, two steps out as he jumps on the gas. The 06 of Morad in there, too.
Kennington gets up out of the groove, laps of it to the inside. Kennington slams the door shut.
And a nudge from Lapsovich as they head down the back straightaway.
I don't know, maybe Caden not happy that Kennington slammed the door shut. That's good short track road course racing.
Into turn number six, look at Daniel Moore and the 06. He's got nothing to lose, and there's contact. The 17 slides into the runoff, so does the 47 of Dumoulin.
Oh my goodness, Dumoulin and Kennington, two former winners of this race. I believe there was contact from the 76 of Lapsovich, and we're on to the last lap, Dave Bradley.
We saw LeBay go by as we're waiting for that group to come through, but there is your race leader, as he has been since the drop of the green here today in Trois-Rivières, Quebec. He has made a couple small errors, but they have not cost him all afternoon long.
This is the spot. He's got to nail this corner. This is where he had the problem.
He had a wheel hop last time. He made it right this time. Kevin Lacroix, quick look at the rearview mirror.
You notice that too, spending a lot of time looking up into the mirror.
Well, he knows who's behind him. It's the master of Trois-Rivières, Andrew Ranger.
And he is running out of time. Just a couple of corners left, Dave.
He's going to need a miracle to catch on the bumper-to-bumper Total Lubricants number 74 of Kevin Lacroix. Sat on the pole in record fashion here in Trois-Rivières, Quebec. He raced hard all day long, kept a champion behind him, and now Kevin Lacroix will win for the second time. at Trois-Rivières.
Andrew Ranger going to bring the Mopar number 27 Dodge home in the second position as the total bumper-to-bumper team celebrates. Don Thompson Jr. coming off the top of the pit box, and here's the battle for fifth.
And you can see the 06 of Daniel Morat has managed to get around the 76 of Caden Lapcevich and steal away those important points. Morat trying to hang on. Lapcevich is going to come back strong.
Couple of corners left for Caden to try to make his move. He is going to run out of time. Morat finishes fifth. Lapcevich comes home sixth.
A solid rebound for both of those drivers. Both of them coming home with a good points day. And the cool down lap is on and the celebration is on. Todd?
Handshakes all around, high fives. Don Thompson, the crew chief on that 74. What a race today.
Man, that car was good, but the driver was better. The bumper-to-bumper Dodge has been good all weekend. Got to thank Performance Friction for the great the brakes they have. Thanks for all the crew.
Thanks, Donnie. We'll celebrate.
He won twice in his rookie season in 2015, but this the first time that Kevin Lacroix gets to do the burnouts, and he gets to do it in Trois-Rivières, Quebec.
That's the first time we've seen his eyeballs since the race started, and we almost had a celebration mishap as he spins around doing his donuts, almost caught the 27 of Ranger.
And Alex Taglianni doing some donuts as well. We'll be back to talk with them all in Victory Lane. And welcome back to the Cinquante Tour presented by Can-Am in Trois-Rivières, Quebec, as the drivers get themselves unbuckled in victory lane.
Kevin Lacroix avoids disaster in the last 10 laps to take the win.
The helmet comes off. The Hans device comes off. Kevin Lacroix once again victorious here on the streets of Trois-Rivières. A satisfying smile as he grabs the checkered flag. You said you wanted to control the race. You wanted to lead from the start. You did that. You held the race one wire to wire. How satisfying is two in a row?
Yeah, it's very good. Alex was quite tough on the restarts. He was there, but I knew that if I was clean in corner one, I would be I'll be okay for the rest. So it's so nice to be back on the first step. So glad, yeah.
Congratulations, Kevin Lacroix, victorious two in a row here in Trois-Rivières.
Andrew, in the last couple of laps, wasn't missing much. How are you feeling for second position?
Well, I'm very happy about my team. Mopar Lutech car was pretty fast this weekend. I was trying to save my stuff in the beginning. The pace was really, really fast. And on the restart, I was able to pass Alex because he did a little mistake. And at the end, I tried to catch Kevin, but he was definitely fast. So I try everything. You know, it's very happy about my team. And we gained some points, so this is good.
Thanks.
Thank you.
A smile from both that man, Kevin Lacroix, and from Andrew Ranger. We'll take a look at the finishing order here. How about Alex LeBay, a solid fourth place finish, and Daniel Morat inside the top five?
All three of the Dave Jacobs Go Fast Racing entries in the top 10. Of course, well, LeBay and Earnhardt for the Go Fast Racing, and Daniel Morat also prepared by Jacobs with a solid top 10.
Larry Jackson just outside the top 10 in 11th spot. There you see Raymond Gay in the 20, Fecteau in the 77, Martin Cote coming home in 14th spot.
And on the heartbreak page, Anthony Simone in the 95, Gary Clute in the 59. Tough days for them, and Todd is with Alex.
Alex Taglianni with another third-place effort here at Trois-Rivières. Strong car today. You said you were going to try to fight for everything, and you sure looked like you were doing that today.
Yeah, we did. I mean, we never threw the towel. Obviously, the EpiPen 18 car was good. The team did a good job. I think we made some mistakes over the weekend, but in general, we never threw the towel. We tried everything we got on the restart to try to take the lead, and it was quite a banging there a bit on the straightaway. Unnecessary, because Kevin had a fast car today. I don't think we had anything for him, but when you're not happy about a third, it's it means a lot to our team, and it says what we accomplished so far this year.
Well done.
Thanks, man.
At this point in the season, we are talking about the points picture, and now it's gone from 1 point at the top to 5 points.
Look at Alex Taglianni, 27 points back, so third on back really didn't gain anything, and Lapcevich really didn't lose that much, Dave.
Big applause from the 74 crew and fans in the grandstands as the celebrations continue. There's Dominic Fugere.
Le gagnant,
C'était aussi le gagnant l'an dernier. Il est de Saint-Eustache, Kevin Lacroix.
One of the more celebrated podiums in all of Canadian racing. And what a unique trophy as Kevin Lacroix puts his signature on the Sunoco dump can.
And you can see the names of all the past winners on that, starting in 2007 with Kerry Mix, and now Kevin Lacroix will add his name to the bottom.
He did it in fine fashion, 2 years in a row for Lacroix.
And what a dominant, dominant run for that 74 team. You heard his crew chief, Donnie Thompson, say just what a perfect car it was, and it really was.
He barely turned a wheel wrong all day long. This is a well-deserved win for Kevin Lacroix and that entire 74 team.
Now the picture's on the podium. This NASCAR race on TSN has been brought to you by E3 Spark Plugs, born to burn. By Pinty's, making great food fun. By Bennett Golf Cars. And by WeatherTech, the ultimate interior protection for your vehicle.
Dave, we gotta wait another year before we can come back to Trois-Rivières for a phenomenal weekend of excitement.
This is one of my favorite races on the schedule, and they never fail to disappoint when it comes to excitement. Right off the drop of the green, we had action.
Wow, Gary Klute, 2 years in a row, doesn't make it to turn number two. Patrick Dussault, sparks flying. Kevin Lacroix using every bit of real estate from wall to wall.
And he did it a number of times. Trouble for some drivers, including the 37 of Simon Dion-Vienne, but Caden Lapcevic escaped that one, luckily unscathed for him.
Contact. Alex Tagliani talked about it in his interview, but Kevin Lacroix won the race to turn number one.
Hard battles all the way through this field. The 76 of Lapcevic getting involved a couple of times, including with a past Three Rivers champion. But it's the third win of his NASCAR career for the 74 of Kevin Lacroix.
They're going to celebrate tonight, Dave, and we're off to the Maritimes.
The next race is the bumper-to-bumper 300. It's a return to the ovals. And then you can itch Nova Scotia at Riverside Speedway. For all of us at Fuel Media Lab, we'll see you there.
This copyrighted telecast may not be reproduced, retransmitted, or used in any form without the authorized written consent of NASCAR Broadcasting. NASCAR would like to thank all of our fans for your support, and we hope you enjoy today's broadcast.